For a long, long time, as Linda Ronstadt was saying in her brilliant song rediscovered by the famous Last of Us series on HBO Max, the dedicated GPU market was split between two big names. Nvidia, which unquestionably dominates this segment, and AMD, which enjoys a small but dedicated community. But after the GPU crisis that taught us how much the big manufacturers care about us, the feeling of being safely cradled in the arms of just two competing companies has gone to shit. And that's where Intel comes in, joining the so-called discrete GPU product category with its ARC series dedicated GPUs. Lately, I stopped getting hyped about graphic cards, and that's because I usually have to fake a smile at the end of the video, as I tell you, it's $1,000. But that's exactly why I've been keeping an eye on Intel, with the idea that it would put an end to this crappy tradition. And half a year after launch day, I finally got my hands on an Intel GPU. It is the Acer Predator Bifrost ARC 770 16GB. And since they made me wait so long, I tested it as I pleased, without following any Intel guidelines or list of recommendations. So I mounted the Intel ARC A770 on an AMD platform. Before calling me out for using rich people CPUs, I went with the Ryzen 7 7700X. I know, this one's expensive as well, but it's not the 7950X, and that was also the simplest solution I had around without having to rebuild the test rig from scratch. But before we get to the actual performance of the graphic card, I want to go a bit through the architecture of the new GPUs, because I found it very interesting. You know how iPhones are designed in California and assembled in China? That's pretty much the case with these cards. The Intel ARC GPU series architecture is called Intel Xe and is designed by Intel, except that the actual graphics chip is developed in TSMC's factories using the N6 7nm manufacturing process. We know Intel hasn't yet made the switch to 7nm on their processors, and until their new fabs are ready, they've turned to the next best option. Outsourcing. The Intel Xe architecture is not only interesting, but also as modern as it gets. The Blue Camp's new video cards still come with first-generation DirectX 12 Ultimate support, which means they also support ray tracing, but they come with an in-house developed super sampling technology as well, which is called Intel XeSS. But here we also come across the first limitation of this architecture. DirectX 9 support simply doesn't exist, so older games will be run through a converter that translates DX9 specific commands in a format that DX12 standard can read. But as you might have expected, this has come with other side effects, and some older games will either run poorly or just crash. And this is a recurring theme that I'll expand on later. Going back to the Intel Xe architecture, we also get AV1 encoding and decoding, and this makes ARC video cards a possible solution in the area of productivity and content creation, theoretically. In practice, it doesn't score very well here either, because of the drivers. At the moment, none of the popular video editing software offers support for these video cards, so no Premiere or DaVinci Resolve. Finally, we come to the source of all trouble. Software support. The Intel ARC A770, at least the edition I tested, is a decent card, with a sturdy build, adequate cooling, and an interesting look. On the hardware side, I have no objections. But the thing that turned me down the most was without a doubt the video driver. Before we completely exclude these boards from our list of recommendations, hear me out a little more. At launch, Intel ARC could barely run 2 or 3 games, and those were titles built for these cards. But from then until today, things have changed fast and well. This means that the software development team has been expanding the compatibility list with new and old games, working on stabilizing the GPU and making huge efforts in trying to meet user demands. I'd say let's pat them on the head, at least for encouragement. For those more observant among you, I'll answer right away the question you probably asked yourself from the beginning of the video. Yes, this video card is developed by Acer Predator. I don't know how this collaboration came to be, but I can't say I have a problem with it. Predator's Bifrost is a distribution that uses a slightly weirder cooling system. The card comes in a classic format with turbine type cooling, except that the turbine is in the middle of the brick. It's a 5th generation Aeroblade 3D metal fan, and God knows where the other 4 generations were used. This one is joined by another 92mm Frostblade 2.0 fan designed for the highest static pressure and lowest vibration and noise. These sit atop of a heatsink as big as the card itself, and underneath it we find a vapor chamber covering the graphics chip. All this on a video card with specification of somewhere around an RTX 3060 Ti. So you can guess the temperatures are good, with a high of 68 degrees Celsius recorded in the test sessions. I mentioned the specs, so let's talk about them too. The ARC A770 comes with 32 computing units, 512 graphics cores, and a boost frequency of up to 2200 MHz. The memory is GDDR6, and the A770 comes in 2 variants of 8GB and 16GB respectively. On the power side, we have 2 8-pin PCI Express connections with a 250W Tdp. Connectivity is decent, with 3 DisplayPort 2.0 and 1 HDMI 2.1 that supports 4K at 120fps. Another notable thing about this model is the companion app, Predator by Frost. From here you can overclock the card through an interface similar to MSI Afterburner, you can change colors and lighting modes, and you have a very useful OSD panel. The latter lets you track temperatures and other GPU stats. So Intel video cards, who would have thought? And yet, here they are, or more hastily, here it is. First generation is always make or break for most manufacturers, but I think this time we're getting a good product that promises an interesting future. So I installed it on the test rig alongside the Ryzen 7700X I mentioned and did some tests. I got good results in 3D Mark, where the Intel ARC 770 scores pretty much in the performance zone of the RTX 3060 Ti. We got almost 14K points in TimeSpy, about 30K in Firestrike, and 7500 in Port Royal. Moving on, in Superposition we scored 9500 points. In Blender it's a bit lower, with rather poor results, but I think that has to do with the equally poor software implementation yet. But let me tell you one more thing. The name ARC comes from the narrative arc in video games. Not fucking kidding. So at their core, these GPUs have gaming in their DNA. So we've indulged the gods and thrown in some games. As the card natively supports DirectX 12, I started with games based on this API. The tests were done at full HD resolution, but we also went up to 1440p, as the results didn't look bad. In Apex Legends with max settings, I got an average of 170fps at full HD and a 1% low value of 122 frames per second. Once the resolution was turned up to 1440p, the average dropped to a still respectable 131fps without losing any stability, with a 1% low of 103 frames per second. We're paying respects to the alphabet, and the next game on the list is Cyberpunk 2077, and here the results flopped. The first time I tested the card, I was getting somewhere around 25fps on average at 1440p on high. But just before I got to work on this video, I had to redo the tests because a new driver came out and promised improvements. And just like this, that average went up to 46 frames per second. And there was an anomaly here, as the FPS at full HD didn't jump above 50. God damn it. Poorly optimized game, poorly optimized driver, you don't expect it to work well, do you? Horizon Zero Dawn is a different story altogether, and here I ran the settings at max or ultimate quality, as they are listed in-game, and averaged 79 FPS at 1440p. Once I lowered the resolution to 1080p, I also gained a few extra frames, about 13 to be exact, for an average of 92 FPS. In both scenarios, the 1% low was over 60 frames, meaning perfectly stable and playable. However, not as stable were the results in Marvel's Guardians of the Galaxy. Although the average was great, 91 FPS at 1440p and 109 FPS at full HD, the 1% low values, which indicate stability and the amount that the frame rate fluctuations reach, were embarrassingly low at under 50 FPS for both resolutions. So here I'd say either be careful or drop the details from ultra to high. And the last DX12 game for today is Shadow of the Tomb Raider. It was clear that a 2018 game would run flawlessly, and even more so when it's one of Intel's promoted titles. At full detail, I averaged 86 FPS at 1440p and over 100 at full HD. And this is where I started experimenting, as the game not only supports ray tracing, but also Intel XeSS. I switched ray tracing on and the average frames per second dropped from 86 to 55 at 1440p resolution. I chose this resolution for the ray tracing tests because I also wanted to see the effect of activating Intel's super sampling technology. And once I set XeSS to balanced, the game went back to 78 FPS. Out of curiosity, I switched to the performance setting, which gave me a few more frames, meaning an average of 85 FPS. It's worth mentioning that once ray tracing was activated, the 1% low value dropped drastically from 60 to 35-40 frames. But this is normal, because the GPU has an extra load. But even so, drops were few and the experience stayed decent. What impressed me more was the image quality XeSS offers. To be honest, a comparison between this and AMD's FSR is simply unfair to the red camp. Intel's XeSS maintains image quality almost as well as Nvidia's DLSS does. I also tried this experiment in Cyberpunk 2077 with FSR as well. Yes, it works and you do get a performance boost, but it looks so bad I'd rather play at 30 FPS or not play at all. Before I end this chapter, I also want to talk about performance in other APIs. You didn't have much trouble with Vulkan, and where your game works with the DX12, it works with that as well. But things are different in games using DX11. This is where Shadow of the Tomb Raider is mentioned again in this review, because I compared the results obtained in Microsoft's both APIs. The FPS difference between DirectX 11 and 12 was instantly noticeable. At 1440p resolution, with the settings at maximum, I got 86 frames per second in the test session. But once I launched the game with DX11, it dropped to 65. Same setting. Settings, same test, same system, older DirectX version. And in Borderlands 3, we see the other side of the coin. With DX11, we have an average of 64 FPS, while with DX12, it just doesn't run. And the average of 4 FPS is achieved in the game's menu. Oh, what about gameplay? No, sir. This obviously underlines that Intel drivers are not yet in a stage I can consider final. There are still serious support issues for relatively popular games, see the example of Borderlands 3, and some titles just won't run. But the ones that do work, work well, and make the A770 a serious contender in the affordable GPU segment that can also do 1440p gaming. As Intel expands its support list, I'm sure sales will increase accordingly. The only problem is that we end up in a sort of a paradox, where the manufacturer will be motivated to continue development based on sales, and sales are directly influenced by the value of the product, which is currently down because of the software. Sad, but this is the risk Intel is taking with its first generation of dedicated video cards. Even so, from my perspective, as someone who is reasonably tech-savvy, I really think it's a pretty cool launch. Good product, decent quality, software looks promising, and on top of that, they have eliminated many stability issues. In these 2 weeks I've had the card on the platform, it hasn't given me any serious problems, and contrasts to AMD's new models that messed with my drivers, so I had to restart the rig every now and then. But as excited as I am about the new Intel ARC A770, I can't recommend it. At least not to a customer who just wants a card that run games well, and that's it. Buying such a card right now doesn't make you an early adopter. It makes you a beta tester for Intel, a guinea pig for something that's just taking shape for now. Sure, this form is promising, and I think a tinkering enthusiast will appreciate these GPUs. The foundation is undoubtedly there. Ray tracing, XeSS, AV1, HDMI 2.1, powerful AI cores for various applications and usage scenarios, dual slot friendly format, and good power consumption. And for those who really want to get such an Intel ARC right now, I can't recommend the Acer Predator distribution enough. It's a bit tricky to have yet another piece of software besides the driver, but when this one is some sort of afterburner, I somehow can overlook various other shortcomings. Well, long story short, here's the thing. After countless frustrations with the established manufacturers in this market, either because of price, support, size and consumption, it's good that another company, and especially one of Intel's size, is joining this competition. Of course, Nvidia has over 80% of this market, AMD a little over 10%, and Intel not even half of the latter. But time, and how they will know to speculate on future opportunities, give us reason to hope. Hope for what? That Intel and AMD will become important in this discrete GPU market and that the balance will even out. No matter how excited I am about the quality of the products and the important and permanent innovations Nvidia brings to the segment, I can't help but admit that the current situation is unhealthy and prone to abuse, arbitrary price increases and a-hole behavior from the leader. So let's leave fanboyism aside and give Intel a chance for all our sakes. I don't have any particular sympathy for Intel, given that they've done for years on CPUs exactly what I'm blaming on Nvidia now. What exactly put an end to Intel's arrogance on the desktop processor side? Yes, AMD. And if you also said competition, you gave the correct answer. And that's why this time I have to give Intel a big thumbs up, with the same purpose. To give credible competition to Nvidia, competition from which we, the users, can benefit by a richer and more varied offer, and not least by more humane prices. And with that, I bid you ladies and gents farewell and make sure you subscribe to Technicalities so we can keep giving you looks at what the present and the future bring. Thanks for watching, see you next time.